Hello and welcome to the Saxon Ring for edition 9 of After the Flag. I'm Steve Day, I'm joined as ever by Simon Crafar and Matt Burr as we analyse what's happened here today. Coming up in the show, we talk about the King of the Ring. He's done it again, 10 times, not out, Marc Márquez. We'll look back and see what we predicted yesterday, and we'll just talk about a couple of other things that might be happening as we head into a summer break. So, guys, let's start off with only one thing, Marc Márquez. It seems as though, Simon, I'll start with you. The only risk Marc Márquez took in that race was trying to outbrake everyone into turn one after initially getting off to a poor start, because after that, it didn't look like he had to put much effort into it.
Oh, I can't add much more than what Alberto Puig said to us after the race, and that is Marc was on another planet. And he really was, wouldn't he? I don't think any of us doubted after, anyone in this paddock, even speaking to crew chiefs, team managers, going into the race, no one doubted Marc could run away. The only risk was him making a mistake.
Looked like in the early stages we were hoping, I think, in the commentary box for a decent race. We were certainly hoping that the Yamahas maybe could rough him up in the early stages. It didn't quite happen, did it? Maverick was trying a couple of times down the hill, down the Ralph Waldman curve, but never worked.
Never really got going. You know, once Márquez, he bided his time, he was patient, he put that hard front tyre on. He said he just waited for that to bed in, get heated for those first two or three laps, and then once he was gone, he was long gone. Yet Maverick was so close. You know, his lap times were not far away from Alex Rins and Marc Márquez, but just not quite close enough. And of course, Fabio Quartararo, he got a big hit from Jack Miller in the first corner. That cost him a couple of places. And then, of course, it all went horribly wrong on lap two for Fabio.
Of course, this had a devastating effect on the rest of the field in terms of the World Championship. We'll talk more about that in a bit. Let's just run on to Fabio, because he was one of the first fallers. A real shame to end the German Grand Prix in that way. We'll never know whether he was truly able to fight for the podium, although the way the race panned out, a slightly slower pace, maybe he could have featured.
I think there was a good chance Fabio could have gone with him, you know, because, as you said, especially in the middle there, or I'll be honest, I was impressed with Maverick. I thought he was going backwards, and he figured out how to keep it going and stay in the hunt. But I genuinely think Fabio could have gone with him, you know. It just, he said it was his mistake, just a little one. I'm just super surprised his mistake hasn't been in a race, hasn't come before now.
It was a pace that would have suited him given his physical condition. It wasn't the blistering speed that, you know, he was going to perhaps tire, get fatigued with that dislocated shoulder. So the pace actually suited him. It was a missed opportunity, but a rookie mistake, but we forget that he is a rookie. That's how good he's been so far this year.
Look, guys, we have to then move on to Alex Rins, of course. Rins, again, another really solid start. Got up to a decent pace. It looked like he was going to be the number one contender to Marc here today, but another costly error.
I think Alex looked bang on, best of the rest, didn't he? He really looked good. And I went to the trouble of hunting down his crew chief again, Manu, and said, what happened this time, Manu? And he said, you know, this one is even harder to swallow because looking at the data, we can't see anything he did wrong. The speed was the same. He said the only slight difference was a little bit later turning in on that change of direction, which, as a rider I know, does put more force on the tyre to get back to the same place. But it was minute, he said, so, yeah. Hard to swallow for the team.
You could arguably say, though, Matt, I mean, in the last week, let's be honest, Assenand here, that's what, at least 40 points that have been thrown away there.
Well, he was leading the race in Assen, wasn't he, Steve, when he crashed second here, and a pretty comfortable second. Marc was gone. He could forget about winning the race, but he'd got the measure, or it looked like he'd got the measure, yeah, of Maverick and Cal behind him. So there's another solid 20 points there for the taking. You know, Alex Rins is not a guy who makes these kind of blunders. He's normally Mr. Reliable, Mr. Consistent. I'm really, really shocked that he's made the errors that he has made over these last couple of weeks. Forget it now, his championship has gone. He's going to have to be looking to next year, because those two DNFs in this 7 days have cost him dear.
They certainly have. Let's just quick... Sorry.
Sorry about Alex. I still feel the same about him. He's made these couple of mistakes. Yes, I think you learn. He's not the most experienced guy out there. You learn from your mistakes, and I think he'll bounce back from this.
Well, I think we all agree he'll bounce back. I agree with Matt. I mean, that is championship now.
Oh, gone. Yeah,
over. Let's talk about the guys who are in second and third. We'll start with Maverick, and we'll move on to Cal Crutchlow, because I don't think, well, you'll see from our prediction shortly that anyone of us had Cal in there. A brilliant ride. Maverick, let's say, rejuvenated Maverick Vinales. 7 days now, 2 podiums, a win and a second place. He's going to be really, really pumped about this.
Yeah, you could tell, couldn't you? Yeah. And the Parc Fermé, he was super happy, you know. Biggest grin I think I've ever seen on his face. He was really happy. And I just tried to catch up with the team. I did catch up during the race with Merigali, and I think the team are really proud of how he managed that whole race, you know, and went through that little struggle period where the guys behind were putting pressure on him, fought through it, didn't make a mistake, brought it home.
He knew he wasn't going to race Mark today. Nobody on the planet was going to race Mark yesterday. Maverick did the best thing he could do, and that was bring it home in second place. You know, Yamaha have made strides over this last month or so, certainly with Vinales. You know, I'm angry now for him in Barcelona because he looked like he had really good pace there. This could have been 3 podiums on the spin for Maverick, and the best possible news for him, for me, is they've got that 2020 bike coming at the 100%. Test in Brno, which is going to keep him really fired up, going to keep him motivated. He can see that Yamaha are working really hard behind the scenes, and that's crucial for a rider.
Is this going to be a bit of a bitter pill to swallow then for the other side of the Yamaha garage, for Valentino? I mean, let's be honest, it's been a month to forget in Valentino Rossi's career.
Yeah, I mean, at least he finished. I mean, you know, it would have been 4 DNFs on the trot, which is just unthinkable, isn't it, for Valentino? The problem was qualifying again. You know, at the Sachsenring, if you're that far back, it's going to be really, really difficult. And we saw in the race, he didn't have actually bad pace, but it's just so hard to make any overtakes. And when you're racing Petrucci and Dovizioso, the Ducati's brilliant on the brakes, and those two guys are absolutely sensational on the front end. Joan Mir, I thought, rode really well as well for 3/4 of the race before he hit some grip issues. You know, there's no easy guys to pass in MotoGP. You've got to work so, so hard for those points and places. And it just didn't go Valentino's way again this weekend.
No, I'm waiting for a quote from Merigali about Valley because I wanted it for the show. Hasn't come through yet. But he can't be happy, guys. I don't know what to say, you know. Moving on to Ducatis, I did get to talk to the Ducati guys after the race, and they genuinely feel like it was damage limitation. You know, they got the best that they could out of the race, and they said that he has never been good for them, and we went away for some points.
Well, certainly that seems to be the case. I mean, we may as well stick with Ducati quickly and get some thoughts from you, Matt. I mean, from my perspective, 16 and a half seconds off Marc Marquez is going to be a tough one to take. Danilo Petrucci, though, finishing as the leading Ducati ahead of Dovizioso and Jack Miller here today. He's now within 6 points of Andrea Dovizioso. Still now no win for Dovi since the opening night in Qatar. And, of course, now he's 58 points adrift.
Yeah, I think the worrying thing for Andrea, like he mentioned, Aston, the championship gap, it's big. But who knows what's going to happen? There's still a long way to go.
Yeah, that is true.
You can recover those 58 points. What's going to be concerning Andrea Dovizioso more than anything is that gap between the Ducati now himself and Marc Marquez. I thought Petrucci rode absolutely phenomenal today. I mean, what a weekend it's been for him. He signs that 2020 contract on Thursday. Great, perfect way to start the weekend. Then he's in the gravel at 120 miles an hour.
Yeah, good
turn
point.
9 on Saturday. And to beat your teammate, Dovizioso.
Well, while he was in front of his teammate, I was wondering if the teammate, Dovi, was regretting giving him the help through all the winter and that. Must have gone through his mind, but I'm sure Dovi also sees it as he's not getting the results he should, I think. You know, I think he'll see it like that.
We have to talk about the guy in third place, Cal Crutchlow. What an amazing ride from Cal. He said at the start of the weekend he had pace for the 22s, and it actually worked out quite well because that's what happened in the race, but he didn't make any mistakes. He's back on the podium for the first time since Qatar, and let's be honest, he kept Maverick Vinales very honest.
Well, I mean, a freak accident coming to this Grand Prix, and he proved today he's a freak of nature, isn't he, Cal Crutchlow? I mean, what a ride. I mean, fractured the top of his tibia and his right leg in a really, really bizarre sort of cycling accident, if you can call it a cycling accident. He wasn't even on the bike. Ripped all the tendons and ligaments in that right knee. 17th, I think Cal was in FP4 on Saturday. So people were laughing at us. What they didn't realise was we were working so, so hard to get the best bike for the race, and that bore out today. You know, I think Cal, actually, he would have taken a few more risks to get Maverick had Alex Rins been there. You know, once he knew he was on the podium, once Alex had gone down at turn 11, Cal's thinking, well, I don't need to take those risks now. There's a massive gap back to the Ducatis in fourth and fifth.
Yeah.
I can just sit tight here. But he was pushing because we saw that moment he had at turn number 10. I mean, he was almost on the floor there. I mean, Cal said actually on the last lap he was riding so slowly he didn't even need to brake.
Simon, I know that you admire performances like that when someone comes into something injured and they come out with a podium.
Yeah. Don't doubt me. The only thing I can add to that is, sorry, Cal, I did and absolutely class ride. And, you know, it's so easy to fall off on this track, you know, with the burnt tyres and right at the end when you're trying to push, and he didn't. Class.
Yeah, we know how Cal likes money as well. After the race, he had quite a funny line. I mean, obviously, he did take some important points away from the championship rivals, Petrucci and Dovizioso. It was a good day all round, wasn't it, for Marquez? 10th win in a row, good day for Honda, and Cal said, yeah, well, because I took all those points off the Ducatis, Mark owes me a couple of beers, or he should just donate his win bonus to my bank account.
Good old Cal. Right, let's have a look back at yesterday and see what us three predicted for the race here today, and also the Moto E World Cup race, which took place this morning.
Okay, my prediction for the German Grand Prix, I really, really hope that he has to work for it, but I don't think anyone will be dethroning the king, Marc Marquez. I think he'll take the win tomorrow. I'm going to go I would have gone for Fabio Quartararo second before the shoulder situation. So I'm going to go Maverick Vinales second and Alex Rins third. And in Moto E, wow, an exciting race ahead. He got pole position. I've seen him racing at the front in World Championship racing in World Supersport. So my pick for Moto E is Nicky Tooley.
Well, this is hardly sticking my neck on the line. I'm going for Marc Marquez to make it a perfect 10 out of 10 in MotoGP tomorrow. Really can't call it so tight between Rins, Vinales and Quartararo for those final podium places. I think Quartararo is going to struggle with the shoulder over those 30 laps. So I'm going to go Marquez to win, Alex Rins second and Maverick Vinales third. Now, Moto E, a really exciting new era for the World Championship. I don't think there's going to be any shock, no pun intended, but I'm going for Nicky Tooley, the pole man, to do the business. Let's just hope it's an electrifying race. Another pun for you there.
My predictions for the race. Marc Marquez has been, to me, stunning through practice and qualifying. Looks so confident. I can't see anyone beating him, except himself if he falls off. But I'm going Marc for first. Second and third was so hard in my mind to choose, but I'm going to go Alex Rins and Maverick Vinales. For Moto E, I really don't mind who wins. I think Nicky Tooley's obviously looking really strong. I don't mind as long as there's more of that Eric Granado smoking the rear tyre and maybe a few others doing it as well.
Yes! Yes! It's my first victory of the season. It may well have come just before the summer break, but I'm pumped now. I'm going to come back in the second half of the season.
We're happy for you, Steve.
Okay, come on.
Just a little bit. I'm so gutted about Alex Rins. You know, I was thinking I'm on for my second full house of the season here.
You've got Tooley right as well.
We did get Tooley, absolutely, yeah.
Well, they were the predictions. We'll have to wait and see what happens in the second half of the season. Before we go, guys, a summer break coming up. I think we know who's going into that one happiest of all, a 58-point lead for Marc Marquez. It's going to be a real challenge now. Interesting in the press conference that just went on a little while ago, as we almost get run over.
Advertising.
Yep. They've got themselves some decent advertising in there. Oh, and it's got Czech advertisement as well. That's where we're heading next. They obviously knew we were going to talk about that. Marc Marquez firing a couple of shots. He wins the mind games as well, doesn't he, towards Ducati, saying that second half of the season, I believe it'll be Vinales and Quartararo there again.
Oh, he just loves to get in those sort of psychological digs and jibes, doesn't he, Marquez? I mean, he's so hard to beat on the circuit, but it's so hard to get inside his head and get under his skin off the circuit as well. He's the complete package, mentally bulletproof, awesome on the circuit. You know, he's just going to keep ramping up those mind games the deeper we get into the season. I can't see any way that he's going to blow it.
This one will hurt Ducati, obviously, but if they're not at the races in Brno and Austria, that would hurt a lot more. I mean, we expect to see them back to their best there.
I'll be really surprised if, I was hopeful here that because the Suzukis are closer and the right, you know, Rins is, but it didn't come, you know, Marquez dominated. But I will be really surprised if the Dukes aren't back in the next races. I'll be really, really shocked.
I think the one guy that's going to give Mark the biggest headache in the second half of the season is going to be Maverick. I think Maverick's got some really good racetracks coming up for him and the Yamaha. Brno, he loves Silverstone. Misano, he's really strong at Aragon. Motegi, Phillip Island as well. You know, I think Maverick's going to emerge out of the pack and potentially be Mark's biggest headache in the second half of the year. Not for the championship, but over the individual races.
OK, well, that's almost time up. Guys, what are you up to in the summer break? Matt, you're on holiday with the family, I believe.
Yeah, on holiday in the family, just relaxing on the British coast, sinking a few coldies, as our Kiwi friend would say. Yeah, looking to recharge the batteries and come back looking forward to the second half of the
Simon,
season in Brno.
This job makes me feel a little bit soft. I'm getting soft, so I'm going to chop the firewood for the winter and over the next week, and then we're off to Tuscany annual family holiday.
Well, I've got 3 weeks of changing nappies. There you are, contrasting views from all of us. Thanks for joining us here at the Saxon Ring here this weekend. We hope you've enjoyed it. He's done it again. He's in control. He is the king of the ring. He is Marc Márquez. That's enough from us. We've got, what, 3 weekends off? And then we'll be back for Brno and Austria in the second half of the season.
That was a risky move.
Alex Rins there, breaks in the second place.
Oh, he's down!
He's done it again. It's another mistake from Alex Rins. Devastating win for Marc Márquez as he crushes everyone in Germany. Maverick Viñales makes it back-to-back podiums in second, and Cal Crutchlow, perhaps the rider of the day, in third.
Thank you.